Got a little butterflies? If you don't, work them up. You ought to have just a little bit of butterflies, just a little bit of shake. You get out there, stretch those joints a little bit, and kick there.
If we die together. You can get it done. You can get it done. What's more, you gotta get it done.
You gotta get out there and you gotta block, you gotta tackle, you gotta cover, you gotta protect.
It ain't life or death out there. All we gotta do is go out and do the same thing that we've asked from the first day we started. Do everything as good as you can, and then a little bit more.
As the NFL begins its 75th season, there remains only one living link to the league's earliest days. Arta Bowser was born in 1899 and played with the Canton Bulldogs during the first NFL season. Bowser played every minute of every game at fullback and linebacker for a team that won the league championship. But during the 1920s, college football was king, and the so-called postgraduate game was looked upon as a perversion of the amateur ideal. Still, the strapping young man from Bucknell saw nothing wrong with making the most of his assets.
Well, I was 6'3", and my weight stripped at the beginning of the season was 200. I spent my summers rolling plate glass, Pittsburgh Plate Glass Company, in that heat, and they had me fried down to skin and bones when I weighed in at the beginning. We got paid by the game, $200 a game, and if you got hurt and couldn't play, you didn't get paid. $200 today is peanuts, but I wanted to get married, and I could now see the possibility of getting her a diamond, and made more money than I ever made rolling glass for the Pittsburgh Plate Glass, so at that time it seemed like a lot of money. The one game I played down there along the Ohio River, they'd stocked black coal during the war. And they'd taken all the lumps off, but that black coal dust was all over the field. And the white lines. I wish I'd have had a camera. I never saw such a perfect marked football field, black and white. And it rained, and when that game was over, we were just one solid black mass of that coal dust.
Few players had contracts or loyalty to a single team during the NFL's rag days. On one Thanksgiving weekend, Arta Bowser played four games in 4 days under three different names.
I went to Philly Thursday, took the train up to Mount Carmel, played on Friday, took the train back to Philly, played on Saturday, took the train all night to Canton and played at Canton. Played four times 60s, 240 minutes. No timeout, offense and defense. Finally got back to Lewisburg on Monday and I had some money to put in the bank. I went up to the teller's window and I had this money. And he said, "You must have been lucky in that crap game." I said, "It wasn't crap, it was hard work."
Bowser's travels brought him face-to-face with the legendary Jim Thorpe, then captain of the most unique team in NFL history, the Oorang Indians. This squad, composed entirely of Native Americans, included players named War Eagle, Woodchuck, Joe Littletwig, Bear Behind, and Longtime Sleep. Oorang was not the name of an Indian tribe. The team was actually named for the Oorang dog kennels of LaRue, Ohio. After two losing seasons, the franchise folded. And although Thorpe was past his prime, he still impressed Arta Bowser.
He was strong, he was fast, he was agile, he was brainy. He played hard, but he played clean. I never heard a bad word against Thorpe. And athletes all admired his skill, his ability, his friendship. I think Thorpe was the greatest athlete of the century. I don't think you're gonna have anybody like Sel Thorpe in my short lifetime anyway.
greatest all-around athlete America has ever produced. Ladies and gentlemen, Jim Thorpe, All-American.
The American public would finally come to appreciate Jim Thorpe long after he left the playing field.
How about it? As an athlete, I'm grateful for the strength God gave me. And as an American, I'm grateful for the opportunity our great country and wonderful country has given me.
So always play fair, play hard and play square. Cause that's the All-American way.
Although Thorpe did become an American icon, it was another football hero who first brought the pro game into the national spotlight. Hours after his final college game in Illinois, Red Grange signed with the Chicago Bears and immediately drew the largest crowds the NFL had ever seen, including 70,000 at the Polo Grounds for a game against the New York Giants. In one dramatic stroke, the NFL emerged from obscurity, and Red Grange looked like its savior. But Grange had his own plans.
Grange really made people aware of pro football for the first time. The following year, he came into the meeting in February. He had a manager, maybe the first agent, C.C. Powell, Cash and Carry Powell, they called him. The idea was that Grange wanted to set up his own franchise in New York. Well, there already was the New York Giants in New York. Tim Mara, who was the owner of the Giants, put his foot down and said no. Well, then Powell and Grange went out and created their own league, the American Football League, in 1926. But it was really kind of a crucial moment because it was a question of whether pro football would be run by the star system, so to speak, or the franchise team concept. But in the long run, the NFL survived and the American Football League didn't.
Grange had led a revolt and failed. Later, he drifted back into the NFL, but the spark he had given to the league during his first season had faded. Pro football was once again unloved and unnoticed.
I remember my first trip to Washington, D.C. Senator McKinley called George Halas and myself and invited us to go to the White House and meet President Coolidge. And I remember President Coolidge greeting us, and the senator introduced us as George Halas and Red Grange with the Chicago Bears. And I remember President Calvin Coolidge's remark. He said, "Young men, I'm glad to know you." He said, "I always like animal acts."
In the 30s, America and pro football were in a depression. Like faceless men looking for handouts in empty stadiums, some of the most talented players in NFL history labored in anonymity. The Packers' Don Hutson caught 99 touchdown passes, a career record that stood for 44 years.
Drops back to his own goal, flings the pigskin skyward, and just look at that thing travel, 67 yards. Don Hutson takes it in stride and gallops unmolested for a touchdown. A 92-yard advance, the most beautiful play in many a season.
As a college star at TCU, Sammy Baugh was already football's greatest passer, so when he was drafted by the Washington Redskins, it seemed like a step down for Slinging Sam.
Didn't know one thing about it. I didn't even know how many damn teams I had in pro football. We never heard anything about pro football in those days. I could throw from any position. I did it on my own. No one told me to do it. If I'm playing for somebody who never has thrown the goddamn ball, he can't improve me a hell of a lot. You know what I'm talking about?
Sammy Baugh was a superstar quarterback long before the league had superstars. He can't help but feel that he was born 40 years too soon.
I just love it. I do. I love football. And I like it the way it is today. I wish I was playing today. Man, I like it. Because it's a passing man game, that's the end time.
Featuring some of the most gifted and renowned athletes in the world, the National Football League has become America's most popular spectator sport.
He's got the point. He's got the point.
These men have become more than the sum of their tackles and touchdowns. They have become heroes. And pro football has transcended the field of play to become part of the social fabric of America.
We have a real hunger in this country for heroes. Let's get a little kid.
Want my Coke?
Let's get a tough guy who's an American hero, incidentally. Instantly, it became a football player. It just had to be a football player because football players were tough.
That's the way it should be. I like to see the whole world smiling with me. Coca-Cola has life. Have a Coke and
thanks, Mean Joe.
Heroes in all walks of life speak the language
of
football.
Very early on, we took out the Iraqi Air Force. We did what could best be described as the Hail Mary play in football. I think you recall when the quarterback is desperate for a touchdown at the very end, all of a sudden every single one of his receivers goes way out to one flank and into the end zone, and he lobs the ball.
Touchdown!
Pro football is no longer just a Sunday afternoon pastime. Monday Night Football has made it a primetime passion.
Come on, let's go! Let's go, Bill! Come on!
It turned the game into an event and the players into performers.
I had the cameras. I had 10, 11 cameras on Monday Night Football. I had my cameras everywhere. They couldn't hide from me.
I love you, Mom. Hey, look, you put too much salt in the pound cake last week. I want some chocolate chip cookies, will you? Don't put them damn raisins in it either.
Today's players perform with finesse and fury, above all, with flair. The NFL now boasts the ultimate sports spectacle, the Super Bowl, which has produced 7 of the 10 highest-rated programs in television history. In 75 seasons, 14,372 men have played in the NFL. Most of the originals are long forgotten, but it was the strong backs of men like Artur Bauser that carried the game to where it is today.
Brandon McShew. Wish I could trade with him.
Yeah, all right.
President of the National Football League, Mr. Carl L. Stork.
In Champions of the Gridiron, you will see a dramatic presentation of the great American tradition of clean, competitive sports, played by alert, red-blooded young men who play hard, who play fair, who play the game.
In the early days, the pro game tried to overcome the stigma of being college football's bastard son.
Football is a hard, vigorous, thrilling, and safe game. Safe when the players are in fighting trim, properly trained, and well nourished. The rugged bodies and fine physical and mental strength of these postgraduate players is an example to other players of all ages everywhere.
Then from among the NFL's founding fathers arose a Papa Bear, George Stanley Hallis. He helped create the league in 1920 and coached the Chicago Bears to championships at age 26 and age 68. And it was his passion for professional football that sired a national obsession.
Look, Hallis said, you can have a session with your girlfriend. What's that last you, 20 minutes?
But a win in the National Football League is a thrill that lasts a whole week. And what a thrill.
George, when I met him, was his own press agent for the Bears. He did his own coaching. He played right end. He signed the players. He did his own scouting. He ran the concessions. He was the guy that looked out for the police and everything at Wrigley Field. He was a one-man gang.
Never will forget the time we were having a little trouble holding on to the ball. So he came in and he asked for a football, so I don't know if it was me or somebody that ran up to get it and came back, and he said, this is the way you hold it.
Let's see the way you carry that ball. That's right. As long as you get in that, they can't knock that thing. That's the most important thing right there. We had a fullback by the name of Jacady, and he just set a record of 13 fumbles. I showed him this the next season. He didn't have one.
For the 1940 NFL Championship game against the Washington Redskins, he and Stanford coach Clark Shaughnessy designed the first truly modern offense, the T formation with a man in motion. Just 3 weeks before, a controversial call had helped give Washington a win over the Bears. And the lesson Hallis taught Redskins owner George Preston Marshall after that game would become just as much a part of the modern NFL. How to work the media.
Marshall ran the Bears down something fierce after that goddamn game. He called them a bunch of crybabies and all this damn stuff, you know. Well, if you want to get your team beat, you start calling things like that, you know.
George Hallis, being the great psychologist that he was, he took that newspaper and hung it up right in the dressing room, and he said, here it is. This is what the Redskins and the owners think about you. Is my opinion of you is that you're the greatest football team in America. You got to prove it to yourself, prove it to your family, and prove it to the fans of America.
That pumped them up higher than they were high for the ball game, and we were deader than hell for that ball game.
It was the first game ever broadcast nationally on the radio, but the Bears' new offense was the more impressive innovation. You could turn off a radio.
Your game plan doesn't include 28-0 in the first quarter. I goddamn guarantee you that no game plan is planned that way. So our game plan was out the goddamn window.
With 73-0, Hallis's Bears set a standard of greatness for professional football and made the postgraduate game more than something ex-college players did just for the money.
And you know, we won 4 world championships in 6 years. And the thing that was devastating was that the war broke us up. If it wasn't for the war and all the boys going in the service, and I went in the service for 2 years, all of us were in our early 20s. The monsters of the Midway, they were rough, they were tough, they were mean, they were cruel, but they were so wonderful. They were such marvelous. I'm just sorry that a lot of them unfortunately have passed away. But believe me, there isn't a day or a month that passes where you don't think of that team and the boys on the team and what they meant to you and what you meant to them.
Sid Luckman received a letter from George Hallis that the Papa Bear wrote from his deathbed in 1983.
My dear Sid, I love you with all my heart. And I said this to you last night as I kissed you. I realized 44 wonderful years of knowing you was summed up by 7 words. My boy, my pride in you has no bounds. Remember our word now. Every time I said it to you, you brought me another championship. You wear the luster of twilight that was never tarnished. God bless you and keep you, my son. I love you with all of my heart, George Hallis.
World War II created a new breed of NFL player. This is the face of pro football in the 1950s. It is the face of Chuck Bednarik.
You know, somebody's out there to get you. And boy, you're going to defend yourself. And now you just turn killer. And of course, as the game progresses and in the heat of the battle, you're getting hit. And then suddenly all you think of is, it's that kill. Kill.
This is the way you go after him. You're frothing from the mouth. You say, get him. Get him.
First-generation son of Slovakian immigrants, Concrete Charlie had hands hardened by war. Hands first forged in the shadow of his father's steel mill. Hands once held by a mother who had known only hard times.
Hey, looky here, there, you're on television.
No,
Sony to Robia, Asia.
No, please. No, he will stop. And they... lots of kids wanted to fight him. And they told me, and I told him like that, don't hit him first. But if he hit you, anybody hit you first, give it to him. Give him a good one.
I remember on the 4th down punting situation, I snapped the ball to the punter, and as soon as I brought my head up, pow! Jeez,
My helmet flew off, and I saw these little black dots in the yellow thing, and I also saw the number. Woo. And I went up to him. I said, "You son of a bitch, I'll get you."
Number 65 was Chuck Noll. The feud grew over time.
4 years later, there's Chuck Noll. Lo and behold, the game's over. Here he comes. He said, "Are you ready, you?" And I went, whoom. I mean, I gave him a shot and he went down. Bert Bell fined me $500 and he said, "I want you to apologize to that boy." Now, it takes a little courage to go up to somebody when something like that happened, to say you're sorry. So I remember I was waiting, and then finally I went over and I said, "I want to apologize for what happened in Philadelphia." And he came up close to me and he said, "Bullshit."
No face masks, no holds barred. And they never called a holding penalty for holding a grudge.
These men had come back from the service. They'd been in a war. This was a picnic after what they'd been through. And it was a real competitive, tough proposition.
I can remember being at the bottom of the pile and listening to some of the conversations that go on at the bottom of the pile and some of the actions that go on at the bottom of the pile. You bite some things you might not normally bite. You grab some things you might not normally grab.
This was the growing pains era. This was when we were fighting for recognition. We were fighting for space on television. We were fighting for recognition in the newspapers. And as far as the players were concerned, I think it was a period where it was a lot of fun.
Hold on to your seats for this play, folks, for it'll be a long time before you see another like it. Everyone gets into the act as the wild scramble follows. Big Bill Fisher finally grabs up the loose ball, and the 250-pound guard goes barreling down the sidelines. Fisher has a fine time before flipping to Billy Cross, who hops into the end zone.
A ball carrier was actually allowed to get up and run if he was tackled, as long as the whistle didn't blow and his forward motion wasn't stopped. A new rule in 1950 allowing unlimited free substitution meant that players no longer had to play both offense and defense, and all the best athletes were on offense. Of Hugh McElhenney, number 39 of the San Francisco 49ers, they said he ran like little boys do in their wildest dreams. It was a time when it was okay for little boys to dream, and the NFL was becoming the stuff their dreams were made of.
We'd wait and watch the players come out. I remember the guy that we used to like to see come out because he would be Leo Nomolini, because we'd all say, "Hey, Leo, hey, you look like a big old lion." And he, right across the street from Keys, there was this little dinky little ice cream shop. And we're in there, and Jim Brown came in. We were all just blown away. There's Jim Brown. And I remember saying to him, because I was like the leader of my group, "Man, you ain't so tough. We'll break all your records one day."
The intimacy between the fans and the game turned star players into local heroes. And it would be in the city of Baltimore that the fans' passion for the pros finally reached a level only the colleges had known.
Baltimore didn't really have a college or a university that it could adopt. So that when they had a chance to embrace a pro football team, it was their alma mater. It was the working man's alma mater. Baltimore personalized pro football.
You know, Elise's mother is very upset with Eddie. You see, they picked out this yellow and white motif for the wedding, you know, like we did, napkins, tablecloths, bridesmaids, maid of honor, Holbert. Anyway, Eddie objected. He wanted blue and white. Colt's colors. Refused to give in.
So?
Well, you know how stubborn Eddie is.
Could have been worse.
Could have been black and gold, Steelers colors.
The Colts of the 50s featured 8 future Hall of Famers, including number 24 halfback Lenny Moore, Raymond Berry, Artie Donovan, Gino Marchetti, and a true working-class hero at quarterback, number 19, Johnny Unitas. Unitas was cut as a rookie by Pittsburgh and was playing semi-pro ball in Western Pennsylvania for $6 a game when a friend sent a postcard recommending Unitas to Baltimore coach Weeb Eubank. The Colts gave him a tryout, and Unitas marched them into NFL history in the 1958 NFL Championship game. Although the game wasn't sold out, more people were watching it on TV than had ever seen a football game before. At the end of regulation, the score was tied at 17, forcing the first sudden death overtime in NFL history. Into this scene would step true heroes. Unitas, the golden arm guiding the Colts to pay dirt. Captain Marchetti with a broken leg, refusing to leave the field until he saw his team reach the end zone. And one unsung hero who saved the day for 40 million television viewers.
The Colt fans rushed down from the stands to get close to the field, and they kicked out the main cable with NBC, and they lost the picture. But an unruly fan who probably had a little bit too much spirit, internally and externally, made his way down to the field, and that took a long time. The game had a long wait, and he really kind of saved NBC. He should be their silent hero for all time because he went down and delayed the game. They were able to get back for Alan Horsamichi's final touchdown.
Up over the ball, come the Baltimore Colts. Unitas calling out the signal. Unitas gives Romici.
A win in the National Football League, George Halas had said. What a thrill. What a thrill.
What is that music?
Yeah, it's a Colts marching song. It's very tasteful. Very tasteful.
Bobby Mitchell, who do you think you are? We're getting ready to play a football game, and you're coming down late to get this bus. You're hurting our football, just so you know. And Jim Brown is standing there like this. Now, Jim know he is talking to him. All the things he wants to say to Jim, he is saying through me. It was tough for Paul Brown to attack Jim Brown in front of other players because Jim was so bigger than the rest of us because of his talent, and his intelligence and his ability to control situations. He wasn't a person that you could just, you should have ran that play this way, or you couldn't do that to Jim Brown. And Paul Brown had one person that was different from he'd ever had, and it was tough for him.
Individual self-expression versus organizational discipline. As the NFL was coming of age in the late 50s and early 60s, this conflict was symbolized by the struggle between Jim Brown, the era's greatest player, and Paul Brown, the era's greatest coach.
Paul, in a sense, entrapped himself. He may not have stayed abreast with the mindset of the athlete in those days, and he expected the things to remain much as they had been, in which there was much discipline, much as the military in World War II had had, in which he could count on the player just responding to his every request, and that they would be there when he needed them.
It was said that Paul Brown answered to himself and to God, so long as God didn't try to call any plays.
Paul Brown called all plays. He sent them in because he felt that he would know in a situation better than a quarterback. We disagreed on that totally as a team.
The players were united against him to have him open up the offense and do things that were more innovative. Players always talk among themselves and always think they know more than the coach, and we were no different. But then what happened was that Art Modell came in, bought the team, and that was the end of it because Art eventually got rid of Paul.
In 1963, Art Modell replaced Paul Brown with Blanton Collier. Collier said, "I think the boys like to feel they have a part in running the thing." That year, Jim Brown set a new all-time single-season rushing record.
I did have a resolve to show the general public that Jim Brown was not a player that needed Paul Brown necessarily. And I had the freedom of Blanton Collier, so I was able to express myself fully.
You gang tackled him, you did everything, give him extracurriculars. He'd get up slow, look at you, and walk back to that huddle and wouldn't say a word. Just come at you again and again. You just say, what the hell? What's wrong with this guy? For heaven's sake, when is he gonna stop carrying the ball? How much more can he take?
Greatest run that I ever saw, Jim Brown went left and he came back right and he came back left. And guys kept hitting him and they kept falling off. He bounced back and he scored. And I'm on the sideline, and I just have never seen anything like this. And I'm saying, why God? And then I realized that I was on the wrong side of this deal.
Until you lined up next to this guy and watched him time after time make it come out all right for the Cleveland Browns, you can't fully respect how good he was. If we had the capabilities today to show him from 15 different angles, people would say that was not a human.
Jim Brown ushered in an era in which self-expression flowered and the black athlete flourished.
Give me 18 inches of daylight. That's all I need.
Gale Sayers created new ways to move the football and created the need for new vocabulary to describe it.
Gale planted the foot and went through these people, and I thought I saw him an amoeba-like or paramecium split into two things, and the defensive people went at the wrong one.
The language Sayers spoke on the field was uniquely his own, but when individual self-expression resonates from a cultural base, it can become universal. In the 60s, a New York Giant wide receiver named Homer Jones gave self-expression an entirely new dimension. Homer Jones spiked the ball.
You have a situation where a black individual has paid the price and has achieved success. But when that success is achieved, they find that the vehicles of expressing how they feel about that are insufficient. And so they begin to innovate. And so when you see this continual creativity coming from black athletes, the high fives, spiking the ball, dancing in the end zone, what you are witnessing is the creation of a vehicle to express that joy for which there is no mainstream language.
The joy black athletes can express today is born of a struggle that began 75 seasons ago with an Akron pros end named Paul Robeson and Fritz Pollard, a black man who was Akron's star runner and head coach in 1921. The color line was drawn in 1934.
Let's face it, it was the Depression, and the first people that always suffered during a Depression are minorities. Rather than bear the criticism from the white fans that, my gosh, this black guy's taking a white man's job, they simply ended it.
The NFL remained all white until 1946, when Kenny Washington joined the Los Angeles Rams. Washington, who coincidentally had been Jackie Robinson's roommate at UCLA, lasted only 3 years in the league because of knee injuries. Unlike his performance in an obscure Hollywood production, Kenny Washington played just a cameo role in NFL history.
Does this mean another operation on my knee, Mr. Lenahan?
That's it, Benny.
Too bad I'm not an automobile. Then all we have to do is put on a new wheel.
Yeah.
Washington quietly bore the burden of reintegrating professional sports with his roommate, Woody Strode.
When they got to New York and those places, they said, you can't live with the team. So it was awkward to be not wanted, you understand? I told people, If I had to integrate heaven, I don't want to go.
Washington and Strode were followed by the likes of number 35, John Henry Johnson, and Tank Younger. But since pro football had yet to achieve national prominence, the black athlete's struggle for acceptance in the NFL went unheralded. In the nation's capital, Redskins owner George Preston Marshall would make segregation's last stand.
He used to call me to go to Kiwanis Club or Lions Club or something at noon. Somebody would all, every damn time I ever went, someone would ask this same question. Mr. Marshall, when are we going to have some black football players here? He had the same answer to all of them. He said, we're going to start playing black players when the Harlem Globetrotters start playing white players.
By 1962, it had become a political event, and Congress pressured Marshall to integrate. But only after consecutive seasons in which the Redskins won only one game did Marshall trade for Bobby Mitchell, and he showed him some century-old Southern hospitality.
We break camp, we come into Washington and have the welcome home luncheon. I'm standing there, and everybody stands up. And the shock for me was they started singing Dixie. And I'm standing there, and I'm looking around, and everybody just singing their hearts out. And George Preston Marshall was on the next podium down from me. And he turned around, and he looked up at me, and he said, Bobby Mitchell, sing! Just as loud. And I just started to mouth. I didn't even know the words.
Mitchell rose above the insults, and his Hall of Fame talent and grace helped restore the Redskins to respectability. The rise of the black athlete in modern pro football was originally set in motion back in 1946. The Cleveland Browns featured future Hall of Famers Bill Willis and number 76, Marion Motley. They were the first black athletes to play leading roles in a championship offense, an offense designed by none other than Paul Brown, the man who virtually invented the modern game. Brown was the first to fully utilize coaches in the press box, the first to call every play from the sideline. He set the trend emphasizing speed in the long pass and invented the most basic method of protecting the quarterback.
He brought in the modern pass blocking concepts, and that was very significant because if you look at some of those old systems, they were completing 35% of their passes. Pass blocking schemes were out of whack. They didn't know, they didn't have a clue. Here comes Paul Brown with the cup system. He had everybody turning out, and it was so simple that you wonder why nobody thought of it before, but they just didn't. And so he had Graham throwing out of that cup. Of course, the legend is that when the linemen would break the huddle, they'd all chant, nobody touches Graham.
Otto Graham did get touched once in a while, so Paul Brown invented the face mask. From 1946 to 1955, Brown and Graham led Cleveland to four All-America Conference titles, and after Cleveland joined the NFL in 1950, three world championships. Graham was perfect to play the leading role in Brown's system. He was the All-American boy, the face on the cereal box. After all, not everybody could play for Paul Brown.
In my opening lecture, I always said to them that if you're a bum, a boozer, a chaser, that kind of person, I'm not interested in you making our team.
I heard a story once that somebody once belched in a meeting, and Paul Brown once cut him because of that. The guy went on to become an All-Pro, Doug Atkins. That's the kind of tyrant, respected tyrant, that Paul Brown was.
The tyrant was also a masterful teacher. 11 of the first 28 Super Bowls were won by coaches who once worked under Paul Brown, and he transformed football from a battle of brute force into a match of wits.
I've always said that he put the classroom into pro football. He brought teaching into coaching.
It was just like going back to school. When I arrived at Cleveland Browns, I got a book this thick, and I said, geez, I couldn't wait to get away from the University of Illinois. Here I am going back to school.
By giving IQ tests to the athletes, he made a statement that I want the brightest, most capable people. And suddenly the mental part of the game became very, very important.
While Brown used broad brushstrokes on the bare canvas of modern football, one of his former assistants sketched detailed compositions. Bill Walsh not only found innovative ways for 11Xs to beat 11Os, he created more sophisticated methods to measure a player's football IQ.
When he brought me in, one of the first things he did was to ask me to develop a personality profile inventory instrument. Give it to his main guys, Joe Montana, Jerry Rice, Ronnie Lott, Roger Craig. Show him the profile of his team, and then we want to take every guy that we draft from that point on, do a profile on them, and literally put it up on a transparency and see 49ers are high on competitiveness, this guy's low. 49ers are tremendously high on trust, this guy's low.
Where Paul Brown's players had to meet his arbitrary standards, Bill Walsh let his players set their own standards. And throughout the 1980s, those standards were raised to new heights.
He's out of the 20, quite close again.
We had chances to express ourselves. He allowed guys to be creative. I think that's the reason Joe was able to be the quarterback that he's been over the years. He kind of encouraged Joe to make things happen. He could have definitely held back on that, and he could have definitely kind of said, look, I don't want you to go that to that extreme. And maybe Joe doesn't make that throw to Dwight Clark, but I think that the reason he throws that ball is because he gave him a little freedom.
He has the ball. Montana rolling out the right. Looking toward the end zone, throwing under pressure, throws his pass, caught by Clark, Clark got a touchdown, Clark has it, it's a touchdown for the 49ers!
Perhaps this game-winning play, which in its original design was a Paul Brown play from the 50s, best illustrates how Walsh was able to combine the discipline he learned from Brown with the self-expression he granted his players.
We were very disciplined in what we did, and we were willing to take calculated risks. And we brought contingency football to the forefront. When I say that, I mean we practiced and prepared for every possible contingency that could develop in a game.
Dwight is actually the second receiver. And it was funny because earlier in the year, Bill had us doing this thing, throwing the ball, you know, up to Dwight in the back of the end zone while you're running. And we're sitting there going, come on, you know? I mean, this is something that just happens, you know? You don't practice it. When you got to throw the ball back to that guy, you throw it up and it's thrown away, or he catches it or nobody does. It's basically what he was teaching us, and that's hard to practice. And sure enough, it came into play later in the year.
Bill Walsh took what he got from Paul Brown in terms of organizational discipline and put with it his innate, almost intuitive understanding of men and the relationships and bonding and chemistry processes that go on between them. Bill understood that unless the guys in a football organization care about each other at the level of family, that the organizational level inevitably will fail.
When you see a championship team, it's not so much the coach at some point. At some point, the coach has turned the team over to the team itself. The team demand and expect of each other. In a sense, develop the atmosphere. They can't let each other down.
We know we're the best team. Let's just go out and prove it today. We gotta play hard, play within your limits. Let's go out and kick some ass.
I think the closeness of our teams really showed up in the way that we played. Being able to want to play not just for yourself, but not to let the guy standing next to you down. That closeness that he brought to it and emphasized throughout the years really was a good part of the success.
The greatest accomplishment in the world is not by yourself, it's when you do something with other people.
39 seconds remaining. Montana at quarterback. Back to throw, Montana. Stepped up, throw. Touchdown! And the 49ers have won the Super Bowl.
Everybody sold out this week. Everybody. Damn, it's great, isn't it?
You got a left.
Now let's meet another challenger. Will you enter and sign in, please?
In the early part of the 1960s,
Raymond,
pro football had not yet left a forceful imprint on American culture.
Nitschke, is that right?
On the night after Green Bay's Ray Nitschke was named MVP in the 1962 World Championship game, The panelists of What's My Line were stumped by his occupation.
Score on What's My Line?
Yes. Fine, then let's let the audience...
Their puzzlement was probably shared by most Americans.
What's your line is? All right, panel, we can tell you that our guest is salaried and deals in a service. And let's begin the general questioning with Dorothy Kilgallen.
Mr. Mitski, do you are you connected with the government?
No.
That's one down and nine to go.
But after 1962, pro football's forward march on the cultural landscape was swift and triumphant. The NFL's 13 franchises, which had operated like separate fiefdoms, were unified by Commissioner Pete Rozelle, a promotional wizard who saw that network television could energize a sport whose popularity fluctuated from region to region. Rozelle's vision, and the eye of the TV camera, made pro football a national phenomenon and put a sharper focus on the men who played it.
It occurred to me that it changed the game of football forever. It made it a bigger game, and then in the middle 60s, we started to become personalities, faces instead of helmets.
Hey, you can't park that animal over there. It's illegal.
Mungo love candy.
Mungo like candy.
When Hollywood drafted Jim Brown to fight in World War II, the great running back demonstrated the same form he had used to negotiate the NFL's combat zones. The 60s were defined by hard running and hard hitting. It was a decade dominated by hot-tempered, hairy-knuckled hulks like Pittsburgh linebacker Bill Saul.
That 24 is a little let's wrap him.
Ow! Bruising hits and bone-jarring tackles thrilled the public and fascinated the media. The NFL's warriors were compared to knights and gladiators, and the league's battles took on a mythic quality that was even appropriated by the movies. When the image of a bloody, beaten Y.A. Tittle was reenacted by Charlton Heston, the man who had portrayed Moses and Michelangelo, art imitated life. But it was the other way around for the greatest middle linebacker to ever play the game.
I don't go to the movies too often, but one particular movie that stands out in mind was with Bette Davis. I think it was Hush, Hush, Sweet Charlotte.
Charlotte?
I got kind of a charge when that head come rolling down the stairs. I kind of like to sit there and watch it and see things happen and maybe project those things happening on a football field and not to me.
Dick Butkus and most of the defensive players of the decade maintained a scowl on their faces after the final gun sounded.
Nice try.
Thank you.
Let's get it.
Thank you. We're not allowed, boys. We're not allowed. Don't bug me.
But the Rams' front four kept a song in their hearts.
Well, put them all together, and here at Chindig, we've affectionately dubbed them the Fearsome Foursome. And I was hoping maybe we could persuade you gentlemen to do one more song for us, Rosie. How about that?
You.
Thank you. Here we go. Up and at them.
Show called Chindig asked us to be on it. And that's when we found out we had a problem because Merlin had no rhythm. Merlin Olsen had no rhythm, and I mean none. And I mean, you know, he had on these high-water pants and we had to redress him and, you know, we'd rock his way, he'd go the other way. And we couldn't do our temptation routines because Merlin couldn't keep up. You know, they said that about white guys, you know, no rhythm.
While pro football never cracked America's top 40, it did climb atop the bestseller charts.
My book was about entering this strange world of football players and seeing it from the inside. People really, truly were interested in this new game that had sort of burst upon the frontier of their consciousness. Vince Lombardi once told me that it would never have crossed his mind to have anybody like me join that team. He thought it was the most outrageous idea.
But you know, George, we carry four quarterbacks now. And to ask us to carry five, I think that would be a real headache. I just don't think it will work. Have you tried the AFL?
Many NFL cast-offs did try the wild new league, including quarterbacks Len Dawson and Jack Kemp.
People still come up to me and say, hey, I used to love those old AFL games.
The games were fun, thanks to the coaching and thanks to the entrepreneurial newness of the league and the risk that it was. They had to make it interesting, and it was wide open.
And the National Football League was much like the Big Ten, the three downs and a cloud of dust. They didn't throw the ball very much. We were a passing league. People wanted to see you throw the ball. They didn't give a damn who caught it.
The American Football League's fast-moving, field-stretching style ultimately changed the way pro football was played. But initially, the emphasis on passing was less a strategic ploy than a marketing gimmick.
To interest the fans, we had to put it up. It scored quicker. It rang that cash register, and that's what we were interested in.
When the AFL was formed in 1960, cash registers rarely rang. New York's Titans were one of several franchises plagued by lousy facilities and low attendance.
Their team hadn't caught on yet, because they were fighting the Giants. And for the television, they'd push all the fans over in one section. So when they'd have the crowd shot, you wouldn't see an empty stadium. And they took it another step further. They played canned applause over the loudspeaker. At that time, the National Football League did not take the AFL very seriously. They thought the league would be here and then gone. And interestingly enough, it was that attitude that allowed the AFL to grow, because the result was that the AFL was signing the vast majority of the top college football players.
As a coach, I used to go out on Saturday to watch college players. And I had gone that Saturday to watch Auburn play Alabama. And Sid Gilman said to me, "What'd you see?" And I said, "I saw a guy who tips the field." He says, "What do you mean?" I said, "This son of a bitch plays like he's always going downhill. I mean, he's so good. He plays like he's going downhill." He said, "Who is it?" I said, "A kid Namath out of Pennsylvania."
In 1965, Joe Namath joined the AFL's Jets when the NFL's Cardinals wouldn't take his signing demand seriously enough.
Two representatives from the Cardinals came to my dormitory in University of Alabama, and we met up in my dorm room, and they told me they had drafted me, which I was aware of, and asked me what I wanted to sign. And I told them $200,000, and they both leaned back, "Oh my goodness," you know, fell down on the bed. The guy was standing here and leaned back against the wall screaming like they were in agony. And after they calmed down a little bit, I said, "There's one more thing." "It's what?" I said, "A new car." "They said, a new car too?" I said, "Yes." They said, "What kind of car?" I said, "A Lincoln Continental." And they said, "Oh, that figures. They went nuts.
All right, 75 double choice. Flanker Argo out in Kago on two.
Heavily marketed by Jets owner Sonny Wilburn, the immensely gifted rookie enhanced the viability of the new league and helped effect a merger agreement with the NFL in 1966.
Get points on the board, Joe! Points on the board!
But Namath was a maverick, and to him, the NFL was strictly establishment.
The NFL had great players, but everybody had to wear the hair the same style and wear, you know, behave the same. They didn't have the liberty to be themselves, I don't think. And Mr. Werblin allowed his team, especially me, to be myself. And it was in the fishbowl in New York. You know, it was wonderful.
Sometimes they talk about drinking and conniving around with ladies and stuff. And, you know, it seems almost un-American to me for a bachelor not to, you know, go around having a drink with a lady now and then. And why all of a sudden that's becoming evil in me? I don't know, but some people don't like it. Well, you can't please everybody. I'm just trying to get along, you know, just trying to get by. Look at that shot.
Contrary to NFL football, Sonny Werblin believed in the star system, in making movies and entertainment and filling the stands, putting people on the field that the fans could relate to, or they wanted to come see special, the star system.
When he would leave, say, San Diego Stadium or something like that, and here we are, we're on the road, we're the road team, 5,000 fans after a ball game would be out there just to see Joe Namath, to wave to him, to touch him, and the girls were screaming for him, and the cops that were surrounding him trying to give him protection, they told me they had never seen anything like that since the Beatles.
There he was in New York,
being this grand character that he was. And that ultimately made him a commercial vehicle, above and beyond his football skills, although that's what it was based on. Great athletes, particularly in that era, the biggest risk they could ever take is to try and change, because there is a certain amount of what they do that's almost magic. And Namath found that the magic was in being himself and putting himself out there and pushing the edge of that envelope. Namath was the first great commercial property out of football.
Joe Namath in Beauty Mist pantyhose? Yes, we did it to prove that Beauty Mist can make any legs look like $1 million.
Now, I don't wear pantyhose, but if Beauty Mist can make my legs look good, imagine what they'll do for yours.
Whenever I saw it the first time, I turned my head away. I couldn't look at it anymore. I didn't look at it for years. I really didn't.
But nothing manufactured by mortal man could make Namath's legs look good. During his 13 pro seasons, he underwent 5 knee surgeries.
The idea of Namath after so many surgeries, and you know, which costs him his mobility, which makes everything that he does that much more amazing. And he plays with that horrid pain, and it's like that red badge of courage. You know, a guy who will play with that kind of pain is a guy everybody respects.
By the late 60s, Namath's courage and competitive fire helped establish him as the most celebrated athlete in America. He made headlines with his outstanding deeds and outrageous comments. Like a certain guarantee he made at a banquet prior to Super Bowl III.
I got up to the podium, and about the time I'm getting ready to talk, a guy in the back of the room, "Hey, Namath, we're gonna kick your..." "You don't want..." I said, whoa, wait a minute. I said, "I got news for you. We're gonna win the game, I guarantee it." Our team wasn't getting respect, and that's how the guarantee came out. It was not planned, it wasn't premeditated, it was just anger and frustration, and I really believed we were gonna win the game.
The Jets entered the contest as 17-point underdogs, but game MVP Namath engineered one of the most shocking upsets in sports history. Joe Namath always fancied himself a rebel. But when Super Bowl III reached its climax, he joined a privileged fraternity that has grown in stature over the course of 75 seasons, a fraternity of champions.
When the game ended, there was such a feeling of elation, joy, a tickling explosion inside the teammates. You know, we did it! We did it, you know? It was wonderful. And going off that field, it was kind of like a finality of it. You know, yes, and everybody's cheering. Finally, we did it, we did it, we did it. We were number one. I never put my hand up like that for some reason. I don't know why, but that's the only time. And it was just a feeling. I didn't think about it. It was just, yes, yes, yes. Oh, it was great.
During the NFL's 75 seasons, the image of a champion has taken on many forms and many philosophies.
Professional football has a maxim of take what they give you. We have always operated under a different philosophy of take what we want.
Back is Plunkett. Time to throw. Deep to the end zone to Branch. It is caught by Branch. Touchdown Raiders. Holy Toledo.
We were going deep, and you had to prove during the game that you could stop us. All you did was play hard, and you hit people, and you hit them as hard as you absolutely could, because that was the Raider way. I guess the image started building. The more you win, the more you would get this image. And I remember teams coming on the field and just laying down and letting us beat them. And we were wondering why. Those were good teams with good players, but they just were afraid of that image.
You were always playing against a tough football team, and some of the guys cheated. Some of the guys kicked and bit and hit you in the back, and some of that kind of stuff. Hit you in the back of the head, and it's on film.
In their own way, the Raiders embodied an American ideal. They created a superpower by providing safe harbor for the wretched refuse of the NFL.
I don't think most of these guys are outcasts. I just think they weren't understood.
These guys were nothing but great athletes, but just needed a little bit of love and needed to play football the way it was supposed to be played. Just go out there and play. Go out there and hit some people. Get rid of the rules, and you could be a great player with the Raiders. And I think that's why we were so good.
Rocket giving to Allen, sending a wide left. He has to reverse his feet over the end. And he gets away for a moment.
More than 30 years, the Raiders have lived by their own rules. They don't copy other teams. They don't even repeat themselves. What they do is win. Their tradition and their mystique are unlike any other in the history of the game.
Oakland trails, 10 seconds left. Saber back. Can he throw? He can! A wild scramble, 2 seconds on the clock. Casper grabbing the ball, it is rolled a fumble. Casper has recovered in the end zone. The Oakland Raiders have scored on the most zany, unbelievable, absolutely impossible dream of a play. This one will be relived forever.
Here he is, fading, looking. He's under the gun. He throws. It is.
So you go in a locker room. This is where George Blanda used to dress. So this is where Willie Brown sat. Art Shell sat and dressed right here, next to Gene Upshaw, sat and dressed right here, who was next to Jim Otto, who sat and dressed right here, and they're all in the Hall of Fame. And so that's a certain mystique.
This permeates the entire organization. First and foremost is to win. In a goal-oriented society like we are, our goal is so clear and so singular. It's win. Just win, baby.
While the Raiders were mavericks, the Dallas Cowboys were straight shooters. Their clean-cut image made them America's team. But during the 90s, the Cowboys were rebuilt with stars of a different stripe.
Guy came in, no experience in the NFL, remarkable burst of ego, and immediately took charge. And he said, I'm doing it. I'm running it. It's going to be my team, sink or swim. I'm taking charge of trades, personnel. And by golly, he did. Downside potential was huge. He could have been a laughingstock if everything fell apart.
In just 4 years, Johnson and owner Jerry Jones got rid of the old Cowboy personnel and the old Cowboy image.
Coming right, trying to outrun the coverage, makes a cut, gets it. Oh, he's still going! Oh, look at that! He's going to score! He's got the five! It's a touchdown! Absolutely ridiculous!
So tired!
The team came first. We laughed about it. We said, hey, in the offseason, try to get as much money as you can get.
Where are you headed?
Super Bowl.
Get in. The team has success. There's glory for us all.
While this team bore little resemblance to the squeaky clean Cowboys of yesteryear, they played with a commitment and pride that recaptured the glamour and glory of
America's team.
Here's Haley.
Johnson was only the second coach in Cowboys history. The first one popped up back in 1960, inheriting an error-prone expansion team. Tom Landry was one of pro football's greatest tacticians, and he revolutionized the game on both sides of the ball. But while Landry was a brilliant innovator, he had to learn how to become a motivator.
We would have played for nothing. We loved to play. And what I kept wanting back was this emotional nutrition from these people. Tell me something good about myself.
I said to Coach Land, I said, I really want to go somewhere else. I've got enough confidence in myself, and you don't need to be destroying my own confidence.
Roger Staubach was a passer who loved to run, and he pushed Landry's patience to the limit.
I put up with him calling plays, and he put up with me running, my instincts. And I know he didn't like it. He said, well, you'll learn.
Landry learned that championships could come from Staubach's instincts instead of the game plan.
He can make it funny at times, too. I mean, he said, here's the guy in the hat wants to call this one, but here's the one we're going to use. But he was good.
Staubach led his team to 14 victories in the final 2 minutes, earning him the rank of Captain Comeback.
It was a symbol of solidarity, symbol of home, and symbol of America. If you were going to go to war, you'd love to have, you knew he was going to be there for you, with Mr. America.
No play better defined the Cowboys than a prayer of a pass against the Vikings that became known as the Hail Mary.
Well, the Cowboys need a miracle. Roger takes the snap, pumps it once. He's going long, down the near sideline for Drew Pearson. Pearson makes the catch at the 5, touchdown! Would you believe it?
The Dallas Cowboys have produced 7 Super Bowl appearances and 4 World Championships. They've been America's team because America loves a winner, regardless of who's in charge.
I think Nixon did a lot of great things as President of the United States. I think Lombardi would have done more.
Electing Vince Lombardi president would have only curtailed his power, because in Green Bay during the 1960s, his word was law.
Lombardi, you could hear him over 100,000 people.
Everybody's grabbing out there. Nobody's tackling. Just grabbing, everybody. Grab.
It was like a drill sergeant in the Marines. I mean, you know, this little tyrant. I call him a little tyrant, because that's what he was.
What the hell's going on in there?
What the hell's going on out here?
He would tell us many times, the greatest motivation in the world's fear, period. That's it, you know. If you're gonna lose your job, you're afraid of losing your job, that'll motivate you.
I'll tell you something, Leroy, you're not gonna get your job back unless we get a better performance.
He accepted no excuses.
Pain, there was no pain. Lombardi's idea of an injury, if a bone wasn't sticking out of your leg, you weren't hurt.
The Packers' game plans were basic, but Lombardi demanded perfect execution from his team on every play.
We didn't run the sweep last Sunday worth a damn. We ran it poorly. That'll be the last time we run that play poorly. We're going to run this play all week long until we run it correctly.
If you look at this play, what we're trying to get is a seal here and a seal here, and try to run this play in the alley.
Lombardi's plays stemmed from a simple philosophy, but in dealing with his players, he applied a more complex psychology.
He wanted you emotionally involved, and he would tug and push.
Hup, come on, look at me, 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 look at me.
And pull and pat. Hug and caress and kiss, do whatever he had to do, and he seemed to have a great ability to reach inside you and turn your motor on.
That's what coaching was about with this man. This man was going to absolutely get the absolute best effort out of you that he could get.
I know I'm an emotional man. In order for me, for example, to give everything of myself, to take the mental anguish that's all part of this game, the emotionalism that's all part of this game, in order for me to do this for someone else, I think there has to be a certain amount of love for that other person. There's love for each other, in other words, in the game of football.
This love was returned in the ways the Packers made endless personal sacrifices to ensure the team's success.
The Packers were different because they were the greatest team. The greatest team. Underlined team in the history of pro football. I mean, the Packers were not a talented football team. I mean, when you look at them man for man, you'll find that they wasn't talented, but they had the machine. They had a machine that was grinding into their heads, and they worked together as a unit.
I remember playing in a ball game with a 103 fever and a flu, and I played because I didn't want to let the team down. I didn't play because I wanted the money or because I was afraid to lose my job, but I didn't want to let the team down.
Lombardi built a dynasty. The Packers won 5 NFL titles in 7 years. And what would become their most memorable victory symbolized how sacrifice and execution are the essence of a championship football team.
If I had to pick a drive and a time and a game to explain to you what the Green Bay Packers were all about, I would pick the Dallas game when it was 55 below zero and we moved down the field that 70 yards to score with 16 seconds remaining to beat the Cowboys and go on to Super Bowl II. I think that would pretty well typify what the Green Bay Packers were all about.
In a game known as the Ice Bowl, all that stood between the Packers and a third straight NFL championship was the proper execution of a single play. The little tyrant wouldn't have wanted it any other way.
Here are the Packers, third down, inches to go, to Bader, 17-14, Cowboys out in front, Packers trying for the go-ahead score, Starr takes the snap, he's got the quarterback.
Throughout the 75-year history of the National Football League, many teams have been great, but only one has ever been perfect. The 1972 Miami Dolphins.
It was just a desire to do something that nobody else has ever done in the history of the National Football League. And when we got midway through the season, we realized that we had the opportunity. And then when it got to be 12-0 and 13-0 and then finally 14-0 in regular season, we now realize that we had a chance to be the first undefeated team. I wanted that 17-0, and our team wanted 17-0. And the night before that Super Bowl, the feeling that if we don't win tomorrow, 16-1, which would be a record that a lot of coaches would settle for and be very happy about, would have been a personal disaster.
In Super Bowl VII, the Dolphins were poised for a shutout over Washington. But in the second half, the flawless game face worn by Miami finally sprouted its first and only blemish, courtesy of place kicker Gary Apremian.
We would have put him down 17-0 in a 17-0 season. My God, Gary was a product of destiny. God has smiled on him. All he has to do is kick the ball.
We had the game seemingly in control, and Gary Apremian decided to take matters into his own hands on a bad snap on a field goal attempt and tried to make the great play and ended up making the biggest mistake that you could possibly make and let the Redskins get back into the ball game. It's really a humorous thing now when you look back to realize what Garo tried to do in the dreams that he had of being a hero.
While the Dolphins' 17-0 record is a monumental achievement, Garo's goof still proved the old adage that nobody's perfect. And such pie-in-the-face imperfections have become part of the game's personality.
Well, I think there is an innate love that we all have for someone else's pratfall. I mean, the guy slipping on a banana has always been one of the great classic moments in filmdom and just about everything else.
Signals 14 and 92 and 17 and 76.
And I think the football bloopers films are case in point because while you admire athletic skill, every once in a while to see that these godlike creatures are mortal is ultimately extremely satisfactory. It means that they're one of us.
Myra straight back to pass, looking. Nas stops, throws, completes it to Kilmer up at the 30-yard line. Kilmer driving for the first down, loses the football. It's picked up by Jim Marshall, who's running the wrong way. Marshall is running the wrong way. And he's running it into the end zone the wrong way. Thinks he scored a touchdown. He has scored a safety.
The NFL record book also speaks of wrong-way teams. The sad sack New Orleans Saints, like the trainer of their canine mascot Gumbo, took a long, strange trip into NFL folklore. By making mistakes, the Saints made history as they suffered 20 consecutive losing seasons. To lose consistently is a feat that reveals feet of clay, and no team revealed them more dramatically than the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They dropped a league-record 26 straight games before producing the first win in franchise history. While the Bucks didn't pack much punch, their caustic head coach John McKay always seemed to be packing a punchline.
We got had to scramble out of there quite a lot of sacks.
Well, we didn't block them well, but we made up for it by not tackling.
In the NFL, a thin line separates comedy from tragedy. And when a big game is at stake, losing is no laughing matter.
As a man open in the end zone, caught, touchdown, drop! Dropped in the end zone, Jackie Smith all by himself. Oh, bless his heart, he's got to be the sickest man in America.
You get to the Super Bowl, you've struggled up this mountain, everything is on the line. And all of a sudden, you find it slipping away from you. It's like an illness, and you literally begin to feel your life running out of the soles of your shoes. Sometimes after you've lost a number of times, you can get into a frame of mind where you just want the disease to run its course because you know what the outcome is going to be. And if you get into a thing where you have a recurrent history of losing Super Bowls, it's almost like the night of the living dead.
A lot of pressure. You want to talk about a pressure situation.
Scott Norwood can fire the shot heard round the world now. Here we go with 8 seconds to play. High drama here in the Super Bowl.
Snap, spot, in the air. It's got the distance, it is. No good!
And at the end, you look up at that scoreboard, and you've lost. There's an imbalance there. Everything that you have worked for during the year, even though you are the second most successful team in the league, you have died.
Against the Houston Oilers in a 1992 playoff game, the Bills returned from the dead after being buried by an avalanche of touchdown passes. Early in the third period, Houston had built a 35-3 advantage.
It pours, don't it?
You know, the lights are on here at Rich Stadium. They've been on since this morning. You could pretty much turn them out on the Bills right now.
But the Oilers soon found themselves stumbling in the dark, making the kind of mistakes that proved too costly to be considered football follies. Ultimately, Buffalo mounted the greatest comeback in NFL history, which also meant that Houston relinquished the biggest lead in NFL history.
Receivers, two to the right, back to throw, he looks, he throws, touchdown! Bills can win it here, Wright puts it down, the kick is on the way, and it is good, and the Bills have won it, the Bills have won it, they win it 41-38, incredible, what a comeback by the Bills!
And of all the losses in Oiler history, this has got to rank as the most devastating. They had a 32-point lead.
For four decades, Art Rooney's Steelers defined losing. From 1933 to 1971, they never made the playoffs. Often the most entertaining football in town was played by his sons and their friends in the backyard of the Rooney's modest house on Pittsburgh's north side.
Art lived in that house till he died. Meantime, the neighborhood had become a very run-down neighborhood. Do you know of another NFL owner who wouldn't have been living on Ritzy Street somewhere in some palatial digs? But it shows what a guy of the people he was.
The common man owner had what was commonly regarded as one of the NFL's worst teams. Even on the rare occasions when the Steelers showed improvement, things seemed to just blow up in their face. But in the early 70s, losing became a part of their past.
Andy Russell and I used to wait for the roof to cave in every year, you know, because we'd been with the Steelers too long, you know. Well, the thing I noticed was these guys didn't feel responsible for the history of the Pittsburgh Steelers. This was kind of a new athlete. I came in, I felt responsible for all the years of losing, but they didn't. You know, these were just great players that, you know, they were single-minded in the sense that they were going to be as good as they could be, and the hell with everything else.
That was something great. I must have really put it in there anyway, you know. That's what I'm thinking.
After singing the blues for so long, a team in its town began to make beautiful music together.
Offense, offense, take that football all the way up the field.
The Steelers of those 70s were as huge as athletes could possibly be. And this all came at a time when the economy was starting to decline, the steel mills were closing, and people needed something to talk about that was good. And the Steelers gave that to them, and so they were beloved.
They loved us and adored us because we brought pride to the city for being a champion. Super
Bowl! This Steeltown team cast itself in the mold of other Iron Will champions. Chuck Knoll was a disciple of Paul Brown. The ground attack had the power of Lombardi's Packers. The passing game went deep like Sid Gilman's great AFL teams. And the quarterback had the arm and attitude of Namath.
Terry used to say things like, you can lose with me, but you can't win without me.
But even Terry Bradshaw knew what really distinguished the Steelers from every team which had triumphed before them.
If you said, describe the Steelers, defense.
Oh, they were mean. They were mean.
They played with the ferocity of Butkus.
That'll cool your ass off.
And with Mean Joe Green getting his points across in more ways than one, they dared to be even tougher than Butkus.
He once spit at Butkus on the sideline. Butkus was hollering something. He walked over and spit on him.
Butkus was standing there with this thing hanging down from the face mask, and I said, this is going to be the greatest fight in the history of the National Football League. And Butkus turns around and walks away. I tell you, that was the beginning of the end of the Pittsburgh Steelers' problems.
Pittsburgh's going to the Super Bowl. We got a feeling. Pittsburgh's going to the Super Bowl.
By 1974, the Steelers were poised to win Art Rooney his first Super Bowl.
The desire to get a championship for Mr. Rooney, that was our edge. It was something special. It wasn't about money, it wasn't about fame, but to win that one for Mr. Rooney.
Probably the most emotional time I had was presenting him the Super Bowl trophy. Over and over and over. But in any event, he was so respected in the league. He was a genuine gentleman, Art Rooney.
An uncanny blend of power and grace. The Steelers' style mirrored their chief's personality. A decade of dominance eclipsed a lifetime of losing. Rooney won four Super Bowls in the 1970s. But even when his Steelers became kings of the football world, he remained a king of the fellas.
He was a good, powerful man. He was a good king. Here's a guy that kept hundreds of $1 bills so that he could pass them out on the streets and give them to the poor people and so he could give them to kids. So you can imagine how he felt about his players.
One of the coaches was on my ass all the time, you know, and I remember he was standing there chewing me out and Mr. Rooney walked up. He jumped all over the coach, you know, he says, he took a cigar out of his mouth, he says, this is a good boy, he says, you leave him alone.
He was so generous, so gracious, so kind, that people fell in love with him.
Art Rooney. Boy, I love that man. I know you're watching, Art. I love you. You are always, always by me. I love you so much. Thank you.
As a youngster, we played Sam Lowe football. I used to watch pro football just like everybody. So when I played, when I was on offense, I was a running back. I was Jim Brown. That's who I was. On defense, I was Big Daddy Lipscomb. Those were the people that I admired when I was young and coming up.
I fell in love with football in a little town of Comanche, Iowa, and grew up watching the Bears and the Packers play. My hero was Bart Starr. But like probably most kids, I didn't have the patience to sit there and watch the game. I'd have to grab my ball and go outside and throw it into a tree to catch it.
My nature was attack. Throw it deep. Anybody can throw wide. Let's go deep. You got him playing the huddle, Swan, let's throw a hook. John said, Brad, I got him on a deep curl, 50 yards. Throw it deep, let's go deep. Oh.
Just a tremendously exciting game. It's physical, it can be a ballet, it can be a wrestling match. I think the game of football encompasses probably everything that sport has. And I don't think the game's changed a whole lot. If you look at the skilled positions, they're anything better. I mean, is there a better quarterback than Johnny Unitas or Otto Graham out there today? Is there a better wide receiver than the Raymond Berrys, or better running backs than the Jimmy Browns?
I'm running up the middle, and I get hit by one guy and bounced off him, keep going, then get hit by another guy. Then the guy hits me, my hand goes down, and he hits, and then I come up, and then at the end, one guy grabs me, and I'm still fighting for more yards.
And now it's for the 2,000, boys.
Everybody was just as happy as I was, you know. Not happy for me, happy for themselves. We as a unit were all happy for each other. It wasn't, hey, look what OJ did. It was, look what we did.
When you step into that huddle, you're on an island, and you control the whole scene. The anticipation of greatness or of success that is in that huddle that all 11 of us feel. I'd go into that huddle, and I'd look them all in the eye, and they'd be looking right back at me, and I'd say, what do you guys think?
All right, got 10 plays in us, huh?
Yeah, yeah, let's go.
Okay.
Let's go, baby.
At 85 yards and 10 plays, huh?
Every one of them said, you bet we can.
This guy will go down as the greatest come-from-behind player in the National Football League.
You got to feel like you're the best son of a bitches out there. That's what you're thinking. But nobody is damn better than I am.
Football is accepting pain, tolerating pain, applying pain. Hard hits will make cowards of us all. Football separates the men from the boys.
I don't know what those people had in mind when they first started playing for pay. I remember my dad saying, if they'll pay you for playing, I think you ought to do it. What it's accomplished, I'm not sure, but it's certainly become a part of America.
Where's Ricky Sanders?
Really hard not to let the crowd just distract you to the point where you can't even keep track of what you're doing.
After all these years, Mike, that I could come out here and be nice and relaxed. Geez, I'm a nervous wreck.
But then to make a mistake out there in front of those people, it's horrible.
Lay on that! Oh my goodness gracious!
Can six of you miss a play like that, huh?
All six of you.
The ball jumped out of there as soon as we made contact.
I thought you were talking about you being on the field.
No. What?
This isn't college. You're not at a home college.
I understand.
This is NFL, which stands for not for long when you make them calls. Yeah. I'll be selling groceries.
You got somebody fresh you can put in? If you got anybody fresh, even if they're bad?
Freddie broke his nose. That's what's the matter when he broke his nose.
He never had a good nose anyways.
It's that ball back!
Nice head. Nice head.
Come on, baby. One time. One time. One time, baby. One time.
Tom Dempsey will try to kick the longest field goal in National League history. 2 seconds left. Here's the snap. The ball is down. Dempsey kicks. It's on the way. It's good. The Saints have won. The stadium is wild. Dempsey with
When you talk about a beautiful moment in the game of football, I think of Steve Young against the Vikings.
He runs, gets away again, goes to the 40, gets away again.
That was the most fantastic thing that I have ever seen in all the years I've been in football.
That mountain has been climbed, and the letdown is profound. When they get ready to leave the game for good, it's not the games that they miss. It's not the applause of the fans. What they miss is those guys going to war together, accomplishing things, and being able to look each other in the eye and say, hey, I respect you for what you did.
4 years ago, I came to New York a young Christian man. And now I go home, a young Christian man in a New York Jet. And I'm very proud to say that I'm a New York Jet. And I will be. Forever.
Steve Byrne, this is for you, baby.
Steve Byrne, you and me.
I'll always see professional football as a brilliant shining light for the whole world. You could call it your field of dreams. It's tradition, history, loyalty to the great players who came before us. We owe a debt to all of them, in whose glory we all share.
Professional football is the greatest social common denominator that man has ever known. A inner city black who by happenstance could be sitting next to some dowager from Hunting Valley. That 1 3-hour session, they have a common rooting interest. That's nothing like it.
A lot of fans were older people that had sons or daughters, and they had shared the experience of Jim Brown running the ball as they shared the experience of their relationships. And they loved each other, and those were memories for them. And that was unbelievable for me. I loved that.
If I could start my life all over again, I would be a professional football player, and you damn well better believe I'd be a Pittsburgh Steeler.
There's nothing easy about football, and life isn't always easy. Football convinced me that life is a team game.
Can never recapture the moment when you're standing in Lambeau Field and you score a touchdown and those fans are behind you. That's something special. That's a special time in your life.
There never was and never could be the thrill, the camaraderie, the friendship, the smell of the grass, the feeling, the relationship was one for and all for one. Those are the things you dream about.
I was so real when I was doing those things. I knew I existed. I knew I was on the planet.
Greatest thing I've ever done in my life. I loved every second of it.
I want to thank you very much for making my day in the sun so memorable.